Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In a recent five-part video compilation, Dr. Franklin Anariba, a specialist in electrochemistry, offered his extensive analysis of several papers from the Rosetta mission to Comet 67P. Among the findings Dr. Anariba discussed was the discovery of electric fields and fast-moving electrons close to the comet nucleus, and evidence that electrochemical processes may be responsible for the production of water molecules in the comet's coma. In January, Science News headlines stated that ESA scientists have observed so-called exposed water ice on the comet's surface. However, the term exposed water ice betrays the ongoing assumption that large amounts of ice exist beneath the exterior of the nucleus. We asked Dr. Anariba for his thoughts on this development with the Rosetta mission.
This summary is based on the recent publication titled Exposed Water Ice on the Nucleus of Comet 67P, Churyumov-Gerasimenko by Phil Schoenig et al., published in the journal Nature in January of this year. The manuscript focuses on two icy areas displaying bright albedo patches on the walls of elevated cliffs and debris falls of bedrock material at the bottom of a cliff in the inhabited region. The technique used for the analysis was absorption spectroscopy in the visible to infrared wavelength from 0.25 to 5 micrometers to the visible infrared thermal imaging spectrometer instrument. The authors attribute prominent spectral features at wavelengths of 1.05, 1.25, 1.5, 2.0, and 3.0 micrometers as representative of the presence of water ice, while the wavelength at 3.2 micrometers is interpreted as corresponding to the presence of organic material. Temporal analysis and modeling was performed on the obtained data to derive water ice abundance maps and grain size in a quantitative manner. Best fitting results indicate the presence of pure water ice grains with an average diameter of 2 millimeters, corresponding to 1.2%, and an intimate mixture of water ice grains with an average diameter of 56 micrometers, corresponding to 3.4%, with dark organic material corresponding to 95.4%. To put it in a broader context, the amount of surface water content reported corresponds to only 4.6% of the overall analyzed area, which is in the range of a few tens of meters across. Based on their results, the authors conclude the following. One, these different icy grain populations correspond to different growth mechanisms operating at different spatial and time scales. Two, micrometer-sized ice grains are due to vapor recondensation. Three, millimeter-sized ice grains can be explained by vapor diffusion from deeper and ice-rich colder layers. Four, stratification, open quote, will be the result of cometary evolution processes rather than the remnant of the nucleus formation scenario, close quote. The underlying assumption is still based on a nucleus comprised of icy water and other icy volatiles with a protective organic and refractory material outermost layer that is mixed with water ice content. The data for this publication, as well as the reported findings of surface water ice at the Hopi region and findings through the OSIRIS instrument, are from 2014, months before perihelion. I will suspect that by now, data from the perihelion point is already being analyzed. Hopefully, reports will start coming out soon whereby the water content in the coma, as observed by the MIRO instrument, can be reconciled with surface water presence on the nucleus. Of utmost importance is to correlate surface water ice presence with the point of origination of observed dust and volatile jets. For the condensation sublimation model to retain consideration, it would be necessary to link water ice from the nucleus whether exposed on the surface or at the subsurface level, with water presence on the coma via the observed jets. Additionally, it would be helpful to identify subsurface pressure chambers of volatiles through the localization of vents from which jets can be clearly seen to originate. Otherwise, other models of cometary action may have to be strongly considered. All of these difficulties arise due to the dark and dry surface of the nucleus of 67P. It is a pleasant surprise to read that the authors consider cometary evolutionary processes, which indicate to me the realization that cometary phenomena is rather complex. Having realized the complexity, I have previously proposed the presence of competing mechanisms in action in cometary bodies for the production of water and volatiles. These are: 1. Sublimation of volatiles from the nucleus, provided these are present on the nucleus. 2. Water formation on the surface of refractory material due to proton implantation. 3. Water inorganic material formation due to electrochemical action. It is important to highlight the charge separation, the presence of electric fields, a voltage differential, and ion reconcentration due to electric fields lends support to this mechanism. The current manuscript then falls within the first mechanism.
For continuous updates on space news from the electric universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.